Καλησπέρα. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am Agatha Kalisperas, the director. And on behalf of the Hellenic Center, I welcome you all very warmly. A special welcome to those of you who have come from abroad to support our event. And thank you very much. This evening, we are fortunate to have two most learned speakers, each at the top of their profession. Professor Madoula Tomara Sideri of Pantheon University of Athens, whose particular field of research is the Greek diaspora. And Dr. Nikos Sideris, a psychiatrist, psychoanalyst, and writer, who will give us his thoughts on the relationships within families in the Greek diaspora. These two presentations were triggered by a small book written as a result of observations made by Mitzi David, Dimitra Filaktou. This was when she first arrived in London in the 70s. As a Rhodesian Greek, she could not understand the deep divide between the Greek community and the Greek Cypriot community. She translated her keen observations into a love story, a likely impossibility. But very importantly, she formed the idea and pressured long and hard for the creation of a Hellenic center, which would not only act as a melting pot for the two communities, but would also showcase Hellenism in London and in the UK. So it is very appropriate that the launch of a likely possibility should take place at the Hellenic Center this evening. Before we proceed, I must, by law, I have to show you the fire exit, so we go to the practical. This one here and one the way you came in. And can I please ask everybody to switch off their mobile phones? Thank you. I now invite Mrs. Alexandra Vovolini-Lascari, the publisher and chief executive officer of the Kerkera Publications and Economia Group, and coordinator of this evening's event, to say a few words. So welcome to all our guests. Thank you.
So ladies and gentlemen and dear friends, I'm really very moved and honored to have this position here today as publisher of this little book that says so much. It's by coincidence that I came across it, across the manuscript, through our common friend, Mrs. Davies and mine, Irini Arkoumanis, who is here, who told me one night in London, one rainy night, why don't you look at a manuscript that a friend of mine that you will certainly like, why don't you have a look at it? And I said, okay, if she agrees. And then through Mrs. Kalisperas, I got the manuscript. And I saw behind the lines that it was of such dense, it had such density in ideas and such an historical depth that although we are not publishing fiction, at our publications, we are business publications mainly through Economia Publishing. I said, oh, yes, I would love that to become a book and for people to have access to it because it talks about things that have not been said before. That's my feeling as a publisher of many business stories and history books that my parents wrote, my father and my uncle, my family. It was a rare, small book with an inside strength, if you understand what I mean, if I can say that. It's not proper English, but it's the way I feel. So I'm really very, very happy about that. And it has everything: passion, compromise, cool characters, hot characters. You will see, it's a real page-turner. And each of us, every one of us, can recognize a small part of himself in or in his history in it, especially people like you are today, a crowd that is not living in Greece anymore, but in London or in New York or wherever. I think I've said too much already about the book, but it's you know, it's the way I feel, and I want to pass the word to Professor Matula Tomarasideris. But because all of a sudden she was not too confident with her English, I will read most of what she has written, translated, and then she will add what she feels is most important in Greek. Because she said to me last night that she's afraid to express all these emotions and all her thoughts in English that she's not so familiar with, and instead of speaking not too fluently, she prefers that I read her text. And also I would like to say that Matula Sideris, she teaches historical demography, history of the Greek diaspora, and the history of Greek benefactors, a history that is only partially written to now, and we are working on new projects about that. And she's also teaching history of mentalities. She has written several books and articles. I think our favorite between her and me is a book about the families of Alexandria, especially Choremis, Benakis, and Salvavos, who were interrelated, intermarried. And this book got the prize of the Athens Academy 6 years ago. It's a very, very nice album that we would love to translate in English sooner or later, because these families are also living in the diaspora, the branches. She studies the phenomenon of diaspora, yeah, and more specifically the Greek benefactors of Egypt, so that's Matula. Before reading her text, I want to mention what Dr. Nikos Sideris has done, apart from being a psychiatrist and a family therapist. He's a writer of two national bestsellers with very, very nice titles. I'm very jealous of the other publisher, who is a friend of mine, Metechnio publisher. So the national bestseller is "You Are Not Only the One, You Are Not the Only One Playing." Then "Pezis Mono Esi." There are also others. There are other people, and you must not be so egoistic. That's one. But the biggest bestseller was "You Are Children Do Not Need Psychologists; They Need Parents." Because now it's a very big fashion that we take our children to psychologists. And Dr. Sideris says, no, that's wrong. We have to cope with our children and address the problems, and not just the easy way out. Of course, he would not be so popular.
finally, I have been so popular.
that parents have to be next to the children. Anyway, so that's a brief introduction. And now about family and the diaspora, the presentation. Louder. Oh my God. Oh, I think I'm shouting already. So, but lots of you. So, yeah, I have to think about the ones in the last row. So, family and the diaspora. Ladies and gentlemen, says Matula, it's a great pleasure for me to speak tonight about the Greek diaspora here in London, a city that constitutes a strategically dynamic point for ecumenical Hellenism. Greek diaspora has determined to a large degree the geopolitical constitution and function of Greater Hellenism from the 18th century until today. Indeed, the know-how of organized displacement, very nice words, and of creative networks of migration is a significant factor of Hellenism. Therefore, the knowledge of its history, its study, as well as the preparation for its future are extremely interesting. I'm therefore particularly honored to have introduced this study of this field into the Greek University at the Pantheon. The book that's the topic of tonight's presentation, the book of Dimitra Philaktou, speaks about the endless voyage to Xenitia, to foreign lands, a voyage that forms a large chapter of Greek history. The book shows in a particularly vivid and informative way the trajectories and the different logics of this voyage, which most time morphs into a long leave away from home. It tells us about specific figures of a collective and individual struggle, epic history, as well as about the human cost of these peregrinations. The feeling of diaspora runs through the whole book with particular reference to the Greek Cypriot diaspora that constitutes a special kind of diaspora within the Greek diaspora. The author chooses as her starting point the island Lithos, which means stone in Greek and core, but has more meaning in the Greek dictionary of Dimitrakos, core, beginning, foundation, basis, support. The island Lithos, therefore, defines for the person of the diaspora a destiny. With this island as a point of departure, the sense of diaspora leads to human subjects to their voyage, first to Virginia, and from there to New York, and then to London, managing to narrate successfully the dimension of historical time and historical evolution. Parallel to the Lithos travelers, a Cypriot family goes to Alexandria and then to London and New York. A Likely Impossibility is a life experience novel. Its plot is situated historically in the setting of the diaspora community. The time of the book focuses on the diaspora of the post-war period, while through the journey of the people in the book journeys that are narrated with great agility, the reader can follow, remember, and live with them major historical events. This book contributes to the deeper understanding of topics that belong in the field of social anthropology. The general overview of the family's evolution and the generations that change along with her historic framework are present in this book from the first to the last page. The focus is the microcosm of the shipping community, which is a very secretive, difficult, and demanding world. And I see that there are some people from this shipping world here today, and I hope it will make them think about their role in the future as well and their grandchildren. But at the same time, it's a world very rich in emotions that are hidden. The family structure in the book is according to the external historical circumstances. Next to the parents and children were the uncles, the first cousins, the grandparents, as in the classical Greek family. That changes rapidly, I'm afraid. The relationships between people, the age when they decide to get married, the choice of the best man of the Kubaros, the age and cause of death are crucial demographic questions when trying to understand the constitution of these families. In the genealogical links of the persons, we find the position of the godmother, a spiritual kinship that is established through the religious mystery of the christening, and after that, the continuous care about the young godchild. We also appreciate the special place of the grandmother in the Greek family, the love she gives to the next generation, but also the care she gets from the younger generation. Prominent is the special bonding among people from the same birthplace. Or, when dealing with mourning, it's a major issue for the people of the diaspora, so that the old ways and traditions are kept as much as possible in a foreign place, which is not easy. In all traditional societies, the extended family provides a very strong network of social support, which at times demands personal sacrifice. Often, θέλω, have to take second place so that we stay together. We is more important than me, so that we can continue to share our common identity, our common safety and security. But of course, this has a big personal sacrifice. Communal life in the diaspora creates isles, νησιά, of cultural singularity that try to coexist harmoniously within the environment of the new place of residence. One of the results of living in this closed circuit is that extreme sentiments can flourish. Therefore, the personal choices and wishes of the younger members of this circuit, who try to be autonomous, cannot easily succeed, and are eventually led to resignation of what they want and submission to the older generation, or claiming freedom, rupture with tradition and families. So, people, relationships, thoughts and sentiments transverse the ecumene through real and mental paths created by this lived history of the author that is morphed with the help of the imagination into a novel that speaks to the whole Hellenism of the diaspora, but in terms of history, social anthropology, demography, and psychology. The diaspora journey continues, and it opens and continues. Through the author's art, new trajectories are paved. At the end, we are even taken to Italy, place of origin of an archaeologist who joins the family through his marriage for love with the goddaughter of the heroine. The novel of Mrs. Philactou is a convincing illustration of this change and this new perspective. That's the main introduction of Matula. The full text you can find afterwards at the end in photocopies. But let her express herself in Greek for a short while. Thank you.
Για εμένα απόψε να μιλώ για την ελληνική διασπορά εδώ, στο Λονδίνο. Μία πόλη η οποία αποτελεί στρατηγικό δυναμικό σημείο του οικουμενικού ελληνισμού. Η ελληνική διασπορά αντιπροσωπεύει μια καθοριστική πτυχή για τη γεωπολιτική συγκρότηση και λειτουργία του ευρύτερου ελληνισμού από τον 18ο αιώνα μέχρι τις μέρες μας. Η τεχνογνωσία, μάλιστα, της οργανωμένης μετακίνησης και της δημιουργίας δικτύων μετικεσίας αποτελεί σημαντικό συστατικό στοιχείο του οικουμενικού ελληνισμού. Κατά συνέπεια, η γνώση της ιστορίας του, η μελέτη του παρόντος του και η προετοιμασία του μέλλοντός του εμφανίζουν εξαιρετικό ενδιαφέρον. Γι' αυτό αισθάνομαι ιδιαίτερη τιμή γιατί εισήγαγα στο Ελληνικό Πανεπιστήμιο τη διδασκαλία αυτού του αντικειμένου. Το βιβλίο στο οποίο είναι σήμερα αφιερωμένη η βραδιά εδώ, στο Ελληνικό Κέντρο, το βιβλίο της Δήμητρας Φυλακτού, μιλάει για το αδιάκοπο αυτό ταξίδι προς την Ξενιτιά. Ένα ταξίδι που αποτελεί ένα μεγάλο κεφάλαιο της ελληνικής ιστορίας. Το βιβλίο μας δείχνει με πολύ ανάγλυφο και κατατοπιστικό τρόπο τους δρόμους και τις λογικές αυτού του ταξιδιού, που τις περισσότερες φορές μετατρέπεται σε παρατεταμένη απομάκρυνση από την πατρίδα. Μας μιλάει για συγκεκριμένες μορφές συλλογικής εποποίειας και ατομικής ευποίειας, καθώς και για το ανθρώπινο αντίκρισμα αυτών των διαδρομών. Όλο το βιβλίο το διαπερνά σαν κόκκινη κλωστή η αίσθηση της διασποράς, με ιδιαίτερη αναφορά στην ελληνοκυπριακή διασπορά, η οποία αποτελεί ένα ξεχωριστό είδος διασποράς μέσα στη διασπορά. Η συγγραφέας διαλέγει για αφετηρία της το νησί Λίθος, που στα αγγλικά «stone» σημαίνει πέτρα, πυρήνας, και στο ελληνικό λεξικό του Δημητράκου δίνεται ως πυρήνας, αρχή, θεμέλιο, βάση, στήριγμα. Το νησί Λίθος, λοιπόν, ορίζει για τον άνθρωπο της διασποράς ένα πυρήνα, ένα πεπρωμένο. Με αρχή δράση στο νησί αυτό, η αίσθηση της διασποράς οδηγεί τα ανθρώπινα υποκείμενα στο ταξίδι τους, αρχικά στην Αλεξάνδρεια και από εκεί στο Λονδίνο και στη Νέα Υόρκη, αποδίδοντας με αφηγηματικά επιτυχημένο τρόπο τη διάσταση του ιστορικού χρόνου και της ιστορικής εξέλιξης. «A likely impossibility» είναι ένα μυθιστόρημα βιωματικό. Το ιστορικό πλαίσιο που τοποθετείται η πλοκή του είναι το παρικιακό φαινόμενο. Ο ιστορικός χρόνος του βιβλίου επικεντρώνεται στη μεταπολεμική ελληνική διασπορά, ενώ μέσα από τις διαδρομές που έκαναν τα πρόσωπα, διαδρομές που δίνονται με αφηγηματική δεξιοτεχνία, μπορεί ο αναγνώστης να τα ακολουθήσει, να θυμηθεί και να ζήσει μαζί τους και άλλες μεγάλες ιστορικές στιγμές. Η αναφορά της συγγραφέως στην καταστροφή της Μύρνης το 1922, που γίνεται με αφορμή την καταγωγή του θείου Μάρκου Φλέβου, διευρύνει τον ιστορικό χρόνο του αφηγήματος και του δίνει ένα ιστορικό βάθος 25 χρόνων. Παράλληλα, η υπενθύμηση που κάνει στο κίνημα του Νάσερ το 1952 και στην υποχρεωτική φυγή των Ελλήνων από την Αίγυπτο μετακινεί προς τα εμπρός τον ιστορικό χρόνο του αφηγήματος, τοποθετώντας τον ελληνισμό της διασποράς μπροστά σε καινούριους δρόμους που ανοίχτηκαν προς την Νότια Αφρική και την Αυστραλία αυτή τη φορά. Η γενική επισκόπηση και ανασυγκρότηση των οικογενειών, η διαδοχή των γενεών και η επανατοποθέτησή τους στους ιστορικούς μετασχηματισμούς που συντελούνται, συνοδεύει το βιβλίο από τις πρώτες του σελίδες μέχρι τις τελευταίες. Εστιάζει στο πλαίσιο του εφοπλιστικού μικρόκοσμου, ενός κόσμου κλειστού, δύσκολου και απαιτητικού, αλλά πολύ πλούσιου σε ανθρώπινες εμπειρίες. Ειδικότερα, εστιάζει στο ανθρώπινο τίμημα και στις περιπέτειες που ανακύπτουν όταν η δύναμη των ατομικών αισθημάτων συγκρούεται με τους αυστηρούς κανόνες και τις απαιτήσεις της συλλογικής συμβίωσης, ιδίως στο πλαίσιο της οικογένειας και του σωγιού. Σε κάθε οικογένεια και σε κάθε σόι υπάρχουν πάντοτε ενδογενείς πηγές τριβών, καθώς και ενδογενείς μηχανισμοί αυτορύθμισης και επεξεργασίας των εντάσεων και των αντιφάσεων, οι οποίοι μηχανισμοί υποστηρίζουν τη μακροπρόθεσμη ευστάθεια και εξέλιξη του οικογενειακού συστήματος και των μελών του. Οι μηχανισμοί αυτοί με τη σειρά τους υποστηρίζονται ή παρεμποδίζονται από το ευρύτερο κοινωνικό και πολιτισμικό περιβάλλον όπου εντάσσεται το κάθε οικογενειακό σύστημα. Η δομή της οικογένειας στο βιβλίο που σήμερα παρουσιάζουμε είναι διευρυμένη και όχι πυρηνική. Αυτό δεν μπορεί να αξιολογηθεί έξω από τις ιστορικές συνθήκες. Η εποχή ήταν τέτοια που κυριαρχούσε η διευρυμένη οικογένεια στην παραδοσιακή κοινωνία. Έτσι, κοντά στους γονείς και τα παιδιά τους, συνυπήρχαν οι θείοι, τα εξαδέλφια και οι παππούδες. Ιδιαίτερα όταν μιλάμε για τη διασπορά δεύτερης και τρίτης γενιάς. Η σύνθεση των ατόμων, η ηλικία του γάμου τους, η επιλογή του κουμπάρου, η ηλικία και η αιτία του θανάτου τους αποτελούν κέρια δημογραφικά ερωτήματα στην αναζήτηση της ανασυγκρότησης των οικογενειών και βρίσκονται διάσπαρτα στις σελίδες του βιβλίου. Στη γενεαλογική διασύνδεση των ατόμων συναντάμε τη θέση της νονάς, την πνευματική συγγένεια που εγκαθιδρύεται μέσω του μυστηρίου της βάπτισης και τη συνεχή φροντίδα στο νεαρό άτομο. Συναντάμε επίσης τη θέση που έχει η γιαγιά στην ελληνική οικογένεια. Η αγάπη που δίνει στους απογόνους, στη νεότερη γενιά, αλλά και τη φροντίδα που δέχεται από αυτούς. Διάσπαρτη βρίσκεται και η αγωνία της εγκατάστασης και της σύστασης των αδελφοτήτων, που εξασφάλιζαν τη σύστηξη των δεσμών μεταξύ όσων προέρχονταν από την ίδια ιδιαίτερη πατρίδα. Η διαχείριση του πένθους, κορυφαίο ζητούμενο για τους ανθρώπους της Διασποράς, που μοχθούν να μην χαθούν τα ήθη και τα έθιμα της προγονικής γης. Από την επιλογή του τόπου ταφής, ανάμεσα στον τόπο καταγωγής και στον τόπο υποδοχής, μέχρι τον τρόπο απόδοσης των συλληπιτηρίων στους συγγενείς λοιπόν. Από την άλλη, ο τρόπος που η οικογένεια εμπλέκεται στην επιλογή συζύγου μας υπενθυμίζει ότι ο γάμος στην παραδοσιακή διασπορική κοινωνία είναι συμπεριφορά εκούσια, αλλά όχι και αυθαίρετη. Όσο όμως και αν τα προξενιά που μεθοδεύονταν επιβεβαιώνουν ότι λίγοι γάμοι γίνονταν από έρωτα, η συγγραφέας τονίζει ότι η κινητήρια δύναμη του δράματος που εξιστορεί είναι ο έρωτας και οι συγκρούσεις του με παραδόσεις και οικογενειακές προσδοκίες, οι οποίες τείνουν να υποτάσσουν το ανθρώπινο πάθος σε απρόσωπες σκοπιμότητες. «Σίψ, μέρι σίψ», υπενθυμίζει η Δήμητρα Φυλαχτού, τον σιδερένιο νόμο της παράδοσης. Οι ήρωες του μυθιστορήματος ως τυπική επιφανής εκπρόσωπη της διασποράς, είναι γενναιόδορη απέναντι στη γνώση και στο κοινό καλό. Πιστοί στην παράδοση, ανέπτυξαν τη λειτουργία του ευεργετισμού. Άνθρωποι αθόρυβοι, με προσανατολισμό σε πράξεις ευπηρίας, χρηματοδότησαν την κατασκευή σχολείων και δρόμων που θα εξασφάλιζαν τη μόρφωση και την επικοινωνία. Μαζί με πολλές φιλανθρωπικές πράξεις στην ιδιαίτερη πατρίδα τους, χρηματοδότησαν και την ανέγερση εκκλησίας στη μνήμη του γενάρχη της οικογένειας. Την εκκλησία αυτή αφιέρωσαν στην Παναγία, της οποίας το όνομα ήταν γραμμένο στο πρώτο ταπεινό βαρκάκι και σε αυτήν προσευχόταν πάντα αυτός ο γενάρχης, στη χαρά και στην ανάγκη. Ο παρικιακός βίος και γενικά η συνθήκη της διασποράς καταρχήν αντιστοιχεί στη δημιουργία νησίδων πολιτισμικής και νοοτροπικής ιδιαιτερότητας, οι οποίες νησίδες ούτε ενσωματώνονται πλήρως, ούτε αυτονόητα εναρμονίζονται με το ευρύτερο περιβάλλον του τόπου υποδοχής. Μία από τις συνέπειες της ζωής σε σχετικά κλειστό κύκλωμα είναι ότι οι αδράνειες της οικογενειακής παράδοσης και λειτουργίας ενισχύονται, ενώ οι εντάσεις μεταξύ των γενεών ανακυκλώνονται στο κλειστό κύκλωμα, με αποτέλεσμα αρκετά συχνά οι προσωπικές επιλογές και επιθυμίες των νεότερων ιδίως μελών, τα οποία προσβλέπουν σε μια προσωπική αυτονομία, να μετατρέπονται σε άγονα ενίοτε διλήμματα του είδους παραίτηση υποταγή ή διεκδίκηση ρήξη. Μέσα όμως στο βιβλίο παρακολουθούμε και τη σκληρή μοναχική πορεία των ανθρώπων της διασποράς στον ξένο τόπο, όπως και τις δυσκολίες της καθημερινής ζωής εκεί. Το αίσθημα της παγωνιάς που βιώνουν στην ξενιτιά, μακριά από τη δική τους πατρίδα, και το αντίστοιχο πολιτισμικό χάσμα, όπως δείχνει το παράδειγμα της πλήρους ασυνεννοησίας μεταξύ της ηρωίδας και του καταρχήν καλοπροαίρετου, αλλά βυθισμένου στις προκαταλήψεις του Άγγλου αστυνομικού. Άνθρωποι, λοιπόν, σχέσεις, στοχασμοί και αισθήματα διατρέχουν την οικουμένη μέσα από δρόμους φυσικούς και νοερούς που έπλασε η βιωμένη ιστορία της συγγραφέως και που μεταπλάστηκε με τη βοήθεια της φαντασίας σε ένα αφήγημα σπονδυλωτό που μιλά βαθιά σε ολόκληρο τον παρικιακό ελληνισμό. Ιστορία, κοινωνική ανθρωπολογία, δημογραφία, ψυχολογία. Και το διασπορικό ταξίδι συνεχίζεται. Ανοιχτό και αδιάκοπο καθώς είναι, με την τέχνη της συγγραφέως ανοίγονται νέοι δρόμοι. Στην Ιταλία αυτή τη φορά, τον τόπο προέλευσης του αρχαιολόγου που θα μπει στην οικογένεια μέσω του γάμου του από έρωτα με τη βαφτιστήρα της πρωταγωνίστριας. Και η ζωή συνεχίζεται, επιτρέποντας στην εξέλιξη να τραβήξει το δρόμο της μέσα από τις ποικίλες περιπλοκές της. Το βιβλίο της κυρίας Φυλαχτού αποτελεί πιστική εικονογράφηση αυτού του φαινομένου και την ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ γι' αυτό.
Πολύ ωραία. Κυρία Σιδέρη, νομίζω είσαστε μέσα στο στοιχείο σας με αυτό το βιβλίο. Ήταν γραμμένο ακριβώς για το Πανεπιστήμιο και το κλάδο. Είναι καταπληκτικό, σαν να γνωριζόσασταν από χρόνια. Είναι πραγματικά έτσι μια υπερφυσική δύναμη που μας έφερε εδώ. Και στο τέλος θα μπορείτε να κάνετε και ερωτήσεις, αλλά πριν από αυτό θα μας μιλήσει ο Δόκτωρ Σιδέρης στα αγγλικά, με τη δική του ματιά, από άποψη της ψυχολογίας, για το τι σημαίνουν όλα αυτές οι περίπλοκες σχέσεις.
The title of my presentation is Impossible Lovers. It is a variation on the theme introduced by Mrs. Philactou for her book. Ladies and gentlemen, reading a book from the beginning to the end in two working days means you experience something distinct from all other books you have already read, whatever the echoes from them present in it. This happened to me with the book of Dimitra Philactou, A Likely Impossibility. Its manifest theme is familiar, love and its struggle to overcome external obstacles and adversities springing from differences in social status and family norms between the two persons in love. A variation on the already eternal theme of Romeo and Juliet, the rich and the poor, etc., etc. Beneath the surface struggle of personal feelings against external circumstances, however, another latent plot is unfolding and actually supports the manifest plot. This latent plot takes place beyond the field of sociological phenomena, in the realm of psychological subtleties. Here, the external reality is integrated, not always consciously, through internalization. That is, at the sociological level, we meet a familial pattern, the subject versus the system. At the level of the psychical reality, however, instead of reaction to external factors, the driving force and the organizer is the mental action of the subject, struggling with her and his internal divisions, objections and obstacles, transforming the manifest play of tag into a strange version of the latent play, hide and seek, and more we'll see. With a nuance of importance, each player has to hide not mainly from the other, but from her himself. To avoid the encounter with her his deeper feelings and the resistances to those feelings, to avoid the assumption of and the responsibility for her his desire. The story begins with a setting most classical. Girl meets boy, feelings arise. The ways of the old country do not leave much space for more at the moment. Both invent ways to continue keeping in touch and come closer, and so on. The keepers of the tradition, the parents of the girl, are informed and forbid this love affair. Pain, arguments, constraint and familial conspiracies, finally narrated by the author, put an external limit to the unconvincing possibility of happy conclusion. But this is where the real game begins. Grace to the terms of chance and to the writer's art, what seems clear and obvious becomes obscure and enigmatic. The catch the other play leaves its place to a puzzling play of hide, seek, and never find. So far, the motive force was mutual attraction and its inventions against external adversity. Now on, the driving force is bilateral protection against this mutual attraction, even at moments where external circumstances are clearly or potentially favorable to the retrouvaille des amants, to the reunion of the lovers, widely confused and strangely running away from the object on their desire. This impeded, obstructed desire actually is the principal actor of the story. More precisely, the two lovers do not simply avoid each other because of misunderstandings and circumstances. Rather, each exploits the circumstances and misunderstandings in order to avoid her his profound desire and the painful conflicts this erotic desire inevitably triggers. These conflicts arise when the desires face their internal values, norms, and rules of conduct toward not only others, especially the family, but mainly toward oneself, her, his passions, frames of reference, and matrices of meaning. So, what begins as a delicate pavane, that slow dance of the Renaissance, transforms into a hesitation waltz. Each one employs every available resource in order to avoid a clear and, for this reason, painful subjective position and stance in accordance with one's true desire. Let us now venture more in detail in this strange wasp's nest of passions and of defense against one's own passions. A likely possibility is a literary treatise on transgenerational loyalties, desire and its repression, pain, dignity, work of time, and sublimation. Transgenerational loyalty means two things. First, each person is taught and guided toward actual respect, concern, care, and worry about her/his ancestors. This suggested, eventually imposed loyalty is, however, on the surface. There is also a second version of transgenerational loyalty, whose source is internal. This corresponds to the subjective need of every human, child or adult, to belong to a system of persons and representations, providing security, affection, meaning, and support to her his existence. The exemplary figure obviously is embodied in the child's relation to his family, despite tensions, quarrels, ruptures, or enmities. This is the reason why transgenerational loyalty has a price, the sacrifice of certain personal preferences in order to preserve and to contribute to the continuation of the transgenerational flow of persons and of signifiers, of links and of meanings, assuring the protective sense of belonging to a supporting system. Opposing, transgressing, fighting, or abandoning family traditions and expectations does not entail only external conflicts with persons, parents, relatives, others, but also internal conflicts within oneself, since this transgression may take the colorations of treason, abandonment, isolation, even hopelessness and guilt, as well as a sense of ambiguity concerning one's identity, place, and finally, one's fundamental fantasy, which means one's imaginary description of the world and definition of his place in it. In the book of Dimitra Filatou, the internal conflict between desire and loyalty orders the strange play of seek, hide, and never touch the object of erotic desire. So, loyalty eventually opposes desire. Since one's desire resumes one's true self, it will persist against all odds and will constantly struggle to reach its destination in direct or indirect ways and forms, including suffering or psychopathology. Leaving one's desire as a reprehensible one is not only a source of suffering, it may also be a source of painful pleasure. The narration of Dimitra Filaktou is an exemplary illustration of this process, where time, pain, dignity, and secret enjoyment of suffering are inextricably entangled, until the final denouement of the story, which I will not unravel to you, you may easily guess why. Pain and dignity are intrinsically linked to time and its corollary change. Past or present happiness or suffering are simply steps in a course where alternating situations, positions, attitudes, feelings are the absolute law. A Likely Impossibility is a book about time, historical time, personal time. Time tangibly acting on things, time subjectively experienced as promise and as threat, as something anticipated or avoided, as ominous perspective or as happy encounter. Change is found here a source both of hope and of anxiety. Family is a primordial apparatus for preserving the existing and framing change for transmitting tradition and regulating evolution both at the same time. This double task is not always obviously carried on. Dissonances, frictions, conflicts, crises are inevitable. The question, therefore, is how can family arrange the coexistence of tradition and evolution for the benefit of the whole system and of each of its members? A family means, essentially, rules and consideration. That is, playing by the rules of the game and having in mind that you do not play alone, others play too. And each player has his or her own place, properties, ideas, visions, fantasies, and modes of behavior. Harmonizing these different entities in a game with sufficiently clear and respected rules is the primary aspect of a well enough functioning family, a family driven by respect and affection. Sublimation is a specific psychical mechanism transforming an impossible to satisfy desire into an equivalent which is both realistic and psychically sufficiently satisfying. It corresponds to reformulating one's fantasy in another code, socially acceptable and psychically attainable, able to contain the essential emotional and imaginary quests of the subject. In Dimitra Filaktou's book, we have two types of sublimation. First, a narrative sublimation. What is a brute, intractable passion is repressed. As a permanent wish, it persists, although in the mode of a never-satisfied one. As an interpersonal encounter, it presents itself as a likely impossibility, as an adynaton oikos, adynaton oikos, according to Aristotle, an irresistibly urged for objective, never acquiring a status other than that of pure desire, not of an actual state of affairs. The novel of Dimitra Filaktou, however, offers something more than narrative sublimation. Its perceptible personal connotations prove that not only the heroine of the book, but also the writer of this fine novel has accomplished a lot of precious sublimation precisely through the conception and the writing of the present book. Sublimes incarnated in the metaphorical reality of the fiction. A likely impossibility is a work of sensibility and self-reflection. A venture of intimate passion and fantasy reformulated, as is always the case with the works of art, in a common shared code, the code of the novel. With moments of remarkable felicity, such as, quote, the canvases were abstract flower forms in primary colors, powerful and almost threatening, angry flowers. Such an endeavor of writing, embracing the wanderings of the soul in the turmoil of history, represents a contribution to the harshly tried humanity of our times. I personally, and I presume all of us here present, as well as every reader of this authentic and subtle novel, wish to thank its writer for her courage, her art, and above all, her generosity. Dear Ms. Pilatoum, I know next to nothing about your biography, but your book allows me to say this. You traveled so far, long, hard, deep, and high. With your novel, you unleash a fruitful journey. About it, as well as about many other things, I presume, you may feel satisfied and proud.
Mrs. David would like to say a few words on the podium. Yes, or here.
I would like to thank very much a lot of people that helped the book to come this far. And I'm going to start chronologically. Irina Koumanis, whom I consider as the godmother of the book, sent the manuscript to Alexandra, and to my surprise, Alexandra, who is a very eminent publisher in Greece, but she publishes business books and wonderful coffee type books, agreed to make this the first English language novel that Kerkira Publications has published. So I thank them both. I'm overwhelmed by the comments of our two speakers, Professor Matula Tomara-Sideri, who has found such great, with great perception, what has been in that book. And Dr. Niko Sideri has given us much to think about. Particular thanks go to Agathi Kalispera, who is the director of the Hellenic Center, and she does her job superbly. I would also like to thank her team, who have put a lot of effort and thought into tonight's event. And then I would like to thank each and every one of you for being here to give us support and support a little book. Thank you.